So we have now reached the last phase of our definite integrals chapter, where we are going to evaluate definite integrals as limit of a sum. Okay. So now we are going to evaluate definite integrals as limit of a sum. Okay, we also call it evaluating definite integrals by first principles. Oh, why is this so thick? By first principles. Okay, and people who would have done APs, they would know that this is actually called the Riemann sum. Okay. So those who have written APs, Param is there? No, Param is not yet joined in. Anybody who has written APs, AP calculus, whether AB or BC, this is what they call as the Riemann sum. Okay. So this is an art of evaluating a definite integral of a function from A to B by breaking it into small subregions. Okay, so let's say you are trying to evaluate the area under this function. This function is defined from A to B. So let's say for the purpose of discussion, I assume a continuous function, and we are trying to find out the area from A to B. Okay, so this region from A to B is further divided into subregions. Okay, now there are several ways to divide the subregion. You may divide it in terms of rectangles. Okay. Now the rectangle also can be made in two ways. You can have a rectangle whose edge on the left side touches the triangle. Touches the curve. For example, something like this. Okay. Okay. So let's say you are making rectangles like this, whose you can say left hand. The left hand of the rectangle is always touching the curve. You could also make a rectangle in such a way that the right hand touches the curve. Okay. So these are called the left hand Riemann sum, right hand Riemann sum. But you don't have to know these names, because unfortunately or fortunately, CBSC or JEE is not so much interested in what is left Riemann sum and right Riemann sum. In international books, you'll also find reference to trapezoid rules to find it. So instead of making rectangles, they will make trapeziums. That would be a more approximate way to get the answer. Okay. But anyways, when we are taking the limit of this, as the size of these rectangles become very small, all of them will give you the same result. Okay. So these rules make more sense, or the difference between taking a left-hand Riemann sum, right-hand Riemann sum, a trapezoid rule is more evident when you have taken a very thick size, or you can say you're trying to approximate the integral by making few rectangles. Okay. But right now for our evaluation, since we are aware of the concept of limits, we'll be using it in addition to the Riemann sum to find out this integral. So what do? As I already discussed, we start breaking this entire region into subregions. This subregion will have a thickness of h. Okay. Remember, this h is a quantity which will keep very, very small. It is a tending to zero quantity. Okay. If you keep it bigger, your area would be farther away from the actual value of the integral. So if you want your answer to be closer and closer to the actual integral, your h, that is the thickness of these rectangles, should be tending to zero. And how many subregions we make out of it? We make n rectangles over here. And this n would be a very, very large quantity, you can say, tending to infinity. Okay. So this is your first rectangle. This is your second rectangle, and so on till your last one, which is your nth rectangle. Okay. So in order to evaluate this integral, we will literally take the area of each of these subregions and add them. So what do you think is the area of the first subregion? Now remember, this height is FA. Okay, and thickness is H. So the first subregion area is H into FA. So this is the area of the first subregion. Okay, what is the area of the second subregion? You will say similarly, it will be H. Now, this point that you see here, that will be A plus H. Okay, this point here, that will be A plus 2H. If I continue the same trend, can I say B will actually be A plus NH? Now, this is actually a very important finding for us. We'll use it a little later on. Yeah, let us continue. What is the area of the second subregion? It will be H into F of A plus H. Okay. Third will be H into F of A plus 2H. If I go to the last subregion, that is your Nth region, your area would become this. Okay. Are you finding any problem, disturbances in the net connection? I mean, is my voice audible to all of you?
So it's breaking.
It's breaking. Now it's proper. Yes. Okay. So this will go to the Nth subregion. Now, in order to find the area, we will use the fact that we have to take the limiting case of this as H tends to 0. And n tends to infinity. But normally what do we do is, we drop this condition n tending to infinity, but instead use the fact that nh, now come back to here, nh from here will be what? Nh from here will be b minus a. So we use the fact that nh will be equal to b minus a. Now this is very surprising because n is tending to infinity and h is tending to zero. And we are saying, we're trying to say that a quantity tending to zero into infinity is a finite value. That is quite possible because zero into infinity or tending to zero into infinity is actually considered to be an indeterminate quantity. And an indeterminate quantity can take a finite value. Okay, there's no issue with that. Okay, so please make a note of this. So basically you're taking a limiting case. You are taking a limiting case of the left hand Riemann sum to get to this answer. Now many people ask me, sir, can I take A plus H, A plus 2H and go to A plus NH? Yes, no issues with that. Both of them will give you the same result. Both of them will give you the same result. Don't worry about that. Okay. So I'll just summarize it. Limit H tending to zero. NH is equal to B minus A, H times FA, FA plus H, FA plus 2H, all the way till you reach FA plus N minus 1H. Is that fine? So before we start solving questions, there are certain things that we need to remember from our previous chapters. So as you can see, two things are involved here. One is the concept of limit. Other is the concept of series. So you should be good with your limits, basics of limits, and you should be good with your series. That is the special series, sine series, cos series, even arithmetic, geometric progression, all those things. Okay. So I'll quickly write down those formulas for you so that when we are trying to solve the problem, you don't feel the need to go back to those formulae. So some important formulae for this concept. The first formula is your summation of natural numbers from 1 to n. This is something which you already know. You have been using it extensively. Summation of square of natural numbers from 1 to n. Okay, summation of cube of natural numbers from 1 to n. Okay. next is your GP. GP also many people They keep forgetting the formula. Okay. Sine series. Sine series, that is sine alpha. Sine alpha plus beta. Sine alpha plus 2 beta. I'm sure you know this, but somehow, since you're not using it very frequently, you may have forgotten it. So I'll just quickly write down the formula. This formula is sine n beta by 2 by sine beta by 2 into sine of arithmetic mean of the first angle and the last angle. So alpha n alpha plus n minus 1 beta by 2. That will actually give you alpha plus n minus 1 beta by 2. Okay. This is your sine series. Then is the cosine series. A very similar looking series is cosine series. You don't have to remember too much if you already know your sine series well. Oh, sorry. And again, once again, I want to remind you, if you have not taken your monthly test yesterday, please do so today. Yeah, in a cosine series, only change happens is the sine here becomes a cosine. So it is cosine n minus 1 beta by 2. 2 is only below n minus 1 beta. Okay, it is not below alpha. Is that fine? Okay. Let us try to apply these formulae. In fact, we'll also revisit our limits also. I'm sure you all know it. So one of the most frequently used ones is this guy. H tending to 0, e to the power h minus 1 by h. That is equal to 1. And of course, you know your standard trigonometric limits. Okay. Now, many times we may have to use different concepts to solve the limits. It may not be very straightforward. We'll take few questions just to understand how it works. Let us begin with the first question.
Sir, can you scroll up a little bit?
Oh, yeah, sure. Have you started differential equations in school?
Yes, so we've done
a little too late.
Okay, so today after this session, we'll take up ODE.
Sir, can you move a little to the right?
Right.
Sir, after this, can you move to the previous slide?
Yeah, sure, Mehul.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay. Rahul wants me to go to the previous slide. Yeah, Rahul, this is the most important formula. Please make a note of this. So we are using the limiting case of left Riemann sum to find out the integral of a function from A to B. These concepts would be used in both directions. Not only it'll help us to evaluate an integral as limit of a sum, but also limit of a sum as an integral. That is something that JE asks very commonly. This is something which is more of a subject matter of school exams, and I'm not sure whether CBSE has dropped it. Has CBSE dropped this concept?
Yes, sir. Yes,
oh, sir. My goodness. Okay, anyways, so we'll not spend too much time on this because this is just for your knowledge that we are doing it. So let us say we want to evaluate integral of a function from 1 to 2 x squared dx as limit of a sum. Since this is the first question, I'll help you out with this. So we'll be a little bit faster also. So here our f of x is x square. Of course, a is 1, b is 2. And nh here will be b minus a, which we all know is going to be 2 minus 1, which is 1. Okay, so see, this is how we deal with this. So we take this as a limiting case of h tending to 0, nh equal to 1. Okay, now h fa, fa means 1 square. Isn't it? If you see the formula had a fa. Then it has fa plus h. Fa plus h means 1 plus h the whole square. Then 1 plus 2h the whole square. And so on till 1 plus n minus 1h the whole square. Okay. So limit h tending to 0. Now this term will be opening up as 1 plus 2h plus h square. Then you'll have 1 plus 4h plus 4h square. And so on till it goes to 1 plus twice of n minus 1 h plus n minus 1 square h square. Okay. If you see, you have actually written 1 n number of times. So write an n for that. Then you have 2 h. Let's say I take 2 h common from all these terms. So if you take 2h common, you'll have 1, 2 all the way till n minus 1. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. And we'll take h square common from all these terms, which I'm showing with a white tick. So you will have an h square and you'll have 1 square, 2 square till n minus 1 square. Okay. Now, summation from 1 to n is known to us. So we can also find out summation from 1 to n minus 1. So it will just be n minus 1 into n by 2, and there's a 2h over here, so into 2h. Similarly, this will be n minus 1 n 2n minus 1 by 6, and there's an h square over here, so we'll write h square. Okay. Now, something very interesting is going to happen over here. All of you, please pay attention. This h I'm going to introduce inside. This h I'm going to introduce inside. Okay. Let us simplify to whatever extent we can. Okay. In this expression, you would realize that there will be as many h's as there are factors of n. Interestingly, yes. So as you can see, nh is getting formed over here. Okay, here there are two factors of n. So there's h square over here. So what I'll do is I'll split this h square by giving one h to this and one h to this. Something like this. Okay, and it'll always happen. You'll have as many h's as there will be factors in n. So you have to split that h equally among those factors. Why are we doing that? So that we can make use of this nh equal to 1. Okay. Here also you'll see 1, 2, 3 factors of n are there and there's h cube. So split the h equally among these. Okay. Now wherever you have a nh, put a 1 there, and where you have a single h, put a 0 over there. So this will become 1. This will become 1 minus 0 into 1. This will become 1 minus 0, 1, 2 into 1, minus 0 by 6. Okay. So if you evaluate this, you get 1 plus 1 plus 1 by 3, which is equal to 7 by 3. So we all know integral of x square from 1 to 2 is going to be 7 by 3. So this is how you got the answer, but by using your first principles. Now many books will teach this, or many lectures will talk about this in the beginning of the course. But normally I talk about this in the end of the course because I want to talk more about limit of a sum as a definite integral, not the other way around. So these concepts are primarily important for your basic understanding. I think even in school, they have not entertained this. So we'll take just few more questions, not more. Any questions here? Is the approach clear how to work around with this?
Yes.
Okay. Sir, would there be some case where the sum is easier than the integral?
I'm sorry?
Sir, are there any cases where the limiting sum is easier than the definite integral?
No. Definite integral is, if you are using your methods of definite integral, that will always be convenient than doing it by first principles. It's like, how easy is it to find the derivative of a function by first principles? And how easy is it to find the derivative of a function by methods of differentiation? So first principle is always tedious.
Okay, yes, sir.
Yeah. So let's take this one. Evaluate integral from a to b e to the power x. So I'll take one of exponential, one of trigonometric, and I'll take one of irrational function. Done. Very good. Let's discuss it. So, limit h tending to 0, you will keep nh as b minus a, and it will be h f of a will be e to the power a. When is the NPS Indranagar having semester exams?
The same, 5th.
October. So we'll reduce the duration of the class during those periods. We'll not have 4 hours. Probably we can have 2.5 hours or something. Will that be fine, or are you happy with 4 hours?
4 is fine.
4 hours. 4 hours. Rahul, what about you?
I mean, it's not bad, but yeah, I mean, we can keep probably an hour less.
Theek hai, we'll keep it an hour less. 3 hours, okay. Okay, so, I'm sorry. Yeah. So basically, you can see here that you're dealing with a geometric progression whose first term is e to the power a and common ratio is e to the power h. So it'll be 1 minus e to the power nh. By the way, you can perceive it as if I'm doing this. Okay. by 1 minus e to the power h. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention to the fact that when h tends to 0, this is your standard exponential limit. Okay. And this will become a 1. So we'll have e to the power 1 into e to the power a, 1 minus e to the power nh. E to the power nh is actually e to the power b minus a. So when you open the bracket, you get e to the power a minus e to the power b as your answer. Correct?
Minus 1. Sir.
But there will be a minus 1 here. So there will be this. Yes, there's a minus 1 because it is 1 minus e to the power h. So it'll be e to the power b minus e to the power a. So this is what will be your answer. Okay, try this out. Evaluate integration of sine x from a to b as a limit of a sum. So today we are going to start with differential equations, and differential equations will take 3 classes. Then 1 class for area under curves, and 2 classes for probability, and around 3 classes for vectors. So around 2 months of classes are left.
So we left a few chapters in 11th also, right? Like triangles and a bit of.
That we will revise when we are doing the crash course.
Okay, sir.
Triangle is the property of triangle is the only thing, right?
So there's also something in coordinate geometry, right?
No, coordinate geometry, I think we did a lot of things. Pair of straight lines we did, right?
Yes, sir, we did all that. Okay.
Okay, so... Again here, your function is f of x is your sine x, okay? Nh is b minus a. So your answer would be limit h tending to 0. Nh is b minus a. Sine a plus h all the way till sine a plus n minus 1h. Okay. So this will give you. Now here your alpha is a and beta is h. So this will give you sine nh by 2 by sine h by 2 into sine of arithmetic mean of the first angle and the last angle, which is a plus n minus 1h by 2. Okay. Now, there's an h over here, which I have forgotten. Sorry about that. Now, if you just provide this with a 2 and this with a 2, this would become a 1 because it's a standard trigonometric limit. This would become a 1. Okay. Rest of the places, you will conveniently find an NH combination. So your answer will be 2 sine NH by 2, which is b minus a by 2. This will be sine a plus, this is nh minus h. Nh minus h means b minus a minus 0 by 2. Okay. So this is 2 sine b minus a by 2 into sine a plus b by 2. Okay. This is clearly the formula that we know for cos A minus cos B. Okay. Which we very well know that this will give you cos A minus cos B because the integral of sine x is minus cos. So from A to B, it'll give you minus cos B minus of minus cos. Minus of minus cos A. So that is cos A minus cos B. Is that fine? Now these are easier ones, but there are few where you will get stuck. For example, let's take this question. Evaluate integral of 1 by root x from A to B by limit of a sum, by using limit of a sum. How do you do this? Okay, so you would realize that when you're writing it, I'll also help you so that we don't waste too much time doing this. So when you write down the expression, you have h times, let me write, limit h tending to 0 and nh is equal to b minus a. H times 1 by root a, 1 by root a plus h, 1 by root a plus 2h and so on till you reach 1 by root a plus n minus 1h. So how do you sum this guy? Okay,
so we can use the binomial approximation, right?
Binomial approximation. Okay, okay, so in order to sum this, I will use sandwich theorem. Okay, so I'll try to sandwich this function between two such functions whose sum can be easily be found out. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, all of you please follow here. Can I say the expression of this kind is of the nature 1 by root r. Okay. And r is going from a to a plus n minus 1h. Okay. So let me do one thing. Can I say this expression will always be greater than 2 by under root of r plus h plus root r. Correct? Yes or no? And can I say this will always be less than 2 by under root of r minus h plus root r? Can I say so? Do all of you agree with this or not? Now see, you can treat it as if you have divided by 2 throughout. Okay, let me do this. Let me divide by 2 throughout. Now does it make sense? Because the denominator here will be slightly more than this. So this expression will be lesser than this expression. Similarly here, denominator is slightly lesser than 2 root r. So this term will be more in value than this term. Okay. Now, why have I chosen these two terms is because I'll show you something very interesting. If you rationalize this term both on the left and the right, you can say this term, what happened to my R? Yeah, this term will be under root of R plus H minus root R by H. And this is under root of R minus H minus root R by, or you can just flip the positions here. This will become a minus h, am I right?
Yes. So
minus h, we'll do one thing. We'll just flip the positions. So we'll do root r minus root r minus h by h. Okay. Now let us start putting the values of r as a. So let's put r as a plus h, etc. So when you put a, you get a plus h minus a by h. This will be 1 by 2 root a. This will be root a minus root a minus h by h. When you put a plus h, you will get under root of a plus 2h minus under root of a plus h by h. 2 times a plus h, a plus h minus root a by h, and so on. So dot, 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 I'll just go to the last term. The last term was a plus n minus 1h. Okay, so what will happen to this term? This will become under root of a plus nh minus under root of a plus n minus 1h by h. This will be dot, 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 1 by 2 under root of a plus n minus 1h. And this will be under root of a plus n minus 1h minus under root of a plus n minus 2h by h. Okay. Just add them all. Just add them all. Okay. Now here you realize that when you're adding, a lot of cancellations will happen. And you will be ultimately left with this guy and root a over here. So this will give you under root of a plus nh minus under root of a whole by h. And this is one half of the required sum, whatever we needed. Okay. Similarly, here what will happen? All these terms will start getting cancelled and you'll be left with this guy and this guy. Correct? So that will leave you with under root of a plus n minus 1 h minus under root a minus h by h. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. Now, let us take the limit of the endpoints or the sandwiching functions. Let's see where do they tend to. So I'll just repeat this whole thing again in the next page. Let me just take a copy. Let me take a copy of this. Yeah. Right. Now here, your S will be twice of under root of a plus nh minus root a. Twice of under root of a plus n minus 1h minus under root of a minus 1h. Okay. Now, multiply h. And take the limit of it as h tends to 0. And nh is b minus a. So limit h tends to 0, nh is b minus a. Limit h tends to 0, nh is b minus a. Okay. Now you will see that the moment you put nh as b minus a, this will become under root of a plus b minus a minus root a, which is actually indicating 2 under root b minus root under root a. Okay, now this is something which we don't know. So let me copy it as is it. And this will also become 2 times. Now this will be under root of a plus nh minus h. Nh is again b minus a and h is again a 0. Okay, and this is again h is 0. So ultimately it will also give you under root of 2 times under root of b minus under root of a. What does it mean? That if the limit of these two terms tend to the same value by Sandwich theorem, I can say that the limit of the middle function, which is the sandwiched function, that will also be 2 under root b minus under root. Okay, so this becomes your answer. And this is what we were looking for, right? This is what we were looking for. Okay, so many a times you need to apply Sandwich theorem also to get your job done. Okay, anyways, we'll not waste too much time. We'll directly jump to the part which is more important from JEE point of view. Can I go to the next slide, or you want to copy something here? Done? Mehul, should I go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, limit of a sum as definite integer. Limit of a sum as definite integer. In this concept, we are mostly going to talk about some unfinished agenda of limits. Now, let me tell you, with this concept, your limit concept is completed. We had not completed the concept of limit. If you remember, we started it in the month of March, but even that period, we could not complete it. So with this session, your concept of limit will be completed, where we'll be mostly focusing on tending to zero into infinity kind of forms. Okay. How do I deal with this when it comes to, you know, finding this kind of a limit by use of definite integral, by use of definite integral. So just now we learned that we could write limit of a function from A to B as, integral of a function from A to B as limit h tending to zero, summation of f of a plus r minus 1 h, r going from r going from 1 to n, isn't it? This is what we had learned little while ago. Yes or no? Now, the same thing I will use in a reverse direction to convert a limit problem into a definite integral. We will convert it to a definite integral. So I'll tell you the working rule for it. So let's say you have been given a kind of a limit. I'll take a very simple example. Let's say we have this question. Evaluate. Try to understand through this example, how do we solve such kind of questions? Let's say we have evaluate limit n tending to infinity a question like this. Okay. Now, how do I evaluate this limit? Now, all of you, please pay attention. I'm giving you the working rule over here. Okay. I'm giving you the working rule. So what do we do first? We write down the rth term of this particular series. So what do you think is the rth term of this series? Rth term of the series will be 1 by under root of 4n square minus r square. Correct? Okay. So first term is find the rth term of the series. Okay. Second step is from the rth term, take out 1 by n as a factor. So if I take 1 by n as a factor from it, you obviously will know that you have to take n out from the denominator. So when you take n out from the denominator, it will leave you with this expression. Yes or no? Okay. Okay. Is this step clear? First rth term you have written. From the rth term, you took 1 by n factor out. So 1 by n factor has come out. And because 1 by n factor has come out from this, you'll be left with this. Okay. Now, wherever you have an r by n term, write an x for it. Wherever you have 1 by n term, write a DX for it. Okay, so what has happened? Your Rth term has actually got converted to, I'll write it as a fourth term. It has got converted to 1 by under root 4 minus x square. And this 1 by n will become a dx. Okay. Now, summation means integration. And you're summing from r equal to 1 till, let's say, r equal to n. That means if you put r as 1 over here, x will be a 0. And if you put n over here, x will be n by n, which is 1. In other words, this integral can, this limit can be evaluated by evaluating this integral. Are you getting my point? And I'm sure you can evaluate this. It is 1 by under root a square minus x square form. That is sine inverse x by a. Okay. That is something that, you know, you can always do on your own. So is the process clear? My purpose is to explain the process to you. Result you'll definitely be able to find out. Okay. Are you getting my point? So the agenda is here, in short, that you have to make your Rth term as 1 by n into some function of R by n. This is what you need to do. Okay. And in this, you have to replace your 1 by n with a dx and R by n with a x. Right. And one more thing here. Your limit of integration will be decided by from where to where you are summing up. So let's say if you're summing up from r equal to 1 to, let's say, 2n, then your limit of integration will become 0 to 2. Are you getting my point here? Okay. So if you're, let's say, summing up from r equal to 1 to, let's say, you know, pn. Okay. Then your limit of integration will become 0 to p of f of x dx. Are you getting my point here? We'll take more questions from where the entire process will be much more clear to you. Okay. Let's take a few questions to understand this. Can I go to the next page? Note that some of these integrals, which are of the type tending to 0 into infinity, cannot be evaluated by your, you know, the initial processes that you were aware of. Okay. You have to use definite integrals for it. Oh, sorry. This is picked up from your Arihant book, Amit Agarwal Arihant book. Let us try to target each of these questions so that we are convenient with this process. Let's say you want to do this. Now, you can evaluate this by your summation process also, no doubt. Okay. But for a change, let us do it by definite integrals concept. Right. So you say, sir, I can take n square, LCM, and I can evaluate 1 plus 2 plus 3 till n minus 1. And then I'll use my summation. And you get my answer. Yes, of course you can do it by that way. Okay. But let us, for a change, do it in a different way. So for the first question, what is your TR? Let's go step by step. What's your TR? If you look at it, what's your TR?
R by n square.
Okay. And thankfully, this is your step number one. Thankfully, if you take your 1 by n separately, you'll get an R by n. Okay. Third step, what did I say? R by n is x, 1 by n is dx. Okay, so this is your TR. And if you're summing it up from R equal to 1, see, R is 1 over here. And you're summing it to n minus 1. So if you're summing it from R equal to 1 till n, your limit will become, see, when you're putting R by n as x, you only tell me that when you put R as 1, what happens to x value? Won't it become 0 because n is a very large number? Okay, so lower limit will be 0. And when you put r as n minus 1, you will say the limiting case of this is 1 actually, so your upper limit will become a 1. Correct? So evaluating this is as good as getting solving this integral, which is going to become x square by 2 from 0 to 1, which is half. Okay, so the answer to the first question will be half. And you'll check that even if you use your series, your sum of natural numbers, you'll get the same answer. No difference in the answer. Is it clear? But when it comes to this type of question, right, you would realize the need for a definite integral because your series and all will take a backseat. So I would like you to attempt the second one quickly. Please give me the answer for the second one. Put it on the chat box. Very good, Mahit. And for God's sake, don't write these answers as zero. Many people say, sir, each of them are tending to zero, right? So 0 + 0 + 0 + 0 will be zero only. No, it is actually zero written infinitely many times. In fact, these quantities are very small quantities, but written infinitely many times. And hence they are indeterminate. They are not zero. Had there been a finite number of terms, let's say you're summing up till n tending to 1 lakh, then I would write zero. Okay. But it is not been summed to infinite terms. It is summed to infinite terms. Very good. I'm getting answers from everybody. So your rth term would be 1 plus n, 1 by n plus r, right? Next step, what did I tell you? Take a 1 by n out. If you take a 1 by n out, it becomes 1 plus r by n. Now, this is what I am calling as a function of r by n. This is actually should be written as a function of r by n because we are going to substitute r by n as an x. Okay. So, this term will be 1 by 1 plus x dx. Okay. Now, when you are summing things, means you are integrating. Now, from where to where you are summing? You are summing up from 1 to n. Check here. This term is actually n plus n. So your r is going all the way till n, isn't it? So if your r is going all the way till n, you're summing from 1 to n. That means if your x is r by n, when you put the lower limit, you'll get a 0. When you put the upper limit, you'll get a 1. So it is integration of this from 0 to 1. So it is ln mod 1 plus x, 0 to 1. When you put a 1, you get ln 2. When you put a 0, you get ln 1, which is anyways ln 2 only. Ruchir Singh, how ln 3 and all, yeah? Okay. Try the third one. If you want, I can copy the question once again in the next page so that you have space to work on. In fact, I will have space to work on, not you. Where is definite? Yeah, definite is there. Very good, Chaitanya. Hiya. Ruchir Parekh. Good. Now all of you are giving me correct answers. Very good. So in the third expression, your series goes like n by n square plus r square. As I already told you, you have to pull out a 1 by n from the given expression because that will play the role of a dx. So that leaves you with n square by n square plus r square. But we need to convert it as a function of r by n. So these are the some things that we need to look out for. So it will be r by n the whole square. So now your rth term will be 1 plus 1 by x square dx. Okay. Summation means integration. And you're summing from r equal to 1 till n if I'm not wrong. Yeah. Summing from r equal to 1. So this will be 0 to 1. So this is tan inverse of x formula from 0 to 1, which is pi by 4 minus 0, which is pi by 4. Absolutely. So now let us work on the fourth one. Very good. Hiya, Chaitanya, Mahit. Very good. So this is also very easy. Your rth term here would be r to the power p by n to the power p plus 1. Okay. We are supposed to take a 1 by n out. If I do that, I'll get r to the power r by n to the power of p. So your rth term is like x to the power p dx. Okay. Summing it up from r equal to 1 till n is like integrating it from 0 to 1. So that is x to the power p plus 1 by p plus 1. 0 to 1, your answer will be 1 by p plus 1. Excellent, excellent. So we'll now take up some complicated questions on this. Can I move on to the next page? Okay. Let's take this one. Evaluate limit n tending to infinity n times 1 by n plus 1 n plus 2 1 by n plus 2 n plus 4 1 by n plus 3 n plus 6 da 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 to 1 by 6 n square. Thank you, Kritika, for sharing the schedule with me. So, when is your Ganit exam? Ganit is on Tuesday. Tuesday the 13th. So, they have completed the syllabus, it means, no? What is left? I can't see any chapter left. What are they doing now?
Right now, they're in 3D.
Vectors only is there. 3D is left. Achha. Yeah, they just brush through like anything. Okay, so I've got responses from four of you. Let me see. Oh, no response actually. Yeah, Ruchil. Carry on. You're on the right track, da. Very good, Ruchir. Very good, Pradyut. Ruchir Singh, yeah. Okay, guys, enough time given. Let's write down the rth term. Rth term, if you see very closely, it is actually 1 plus n by n plus r, n plus 2r. Okay. This actually indicates 1 by n plus n, n plus 2n. That's why it becomes 6n square. Okay, so they might not write it in a very obvious way, so that you know you have some problem in getting the series. Now, take a 1 by n out, the customary move that we do always. Okay. Divide by n square, both in the numerator and denominator, giving 1 n to each of the factors. So it will be r by n and 2 r by n. Okay. Now, the moment we have got this, the process becomes very predictable from here. That means your given limit is going to be 1 by 1 plus x, 1 plus 2x dx. Okay. Summation of this is integration. And you're integrating from r equal to 1 to n. So this is 0 to 1. Okay. Now, this is something which you can easily evaluate by use of partial fractions. So I'll not waste time in that. I'll just directly write down the result. So when you break it up as partial fractions, this is what you will see. Correct? So minus ln mod 1 plus x and ln mod 1 plus 2x. Remember, 2 and 2 will get cancelled off, so you don't have to write it. So this whole thing limit is from 0 to 1. So it's minus ln 2 plus ln 3. And other would be 0, so that is ln 3 by 2. Good enough? Any question, any concern here? Here, ln 3 minus ln 2 you'll get. Yeah. Okay, next question. This question you may have seen several times in past. Limit n tending to infinity. N factorial by n to the power n whole to the power of 1 by n. I'm sure many of you would have seen this in your limits chapter also. Okay, now the time has come that we solve this question. You have to take a log here. Please remember, without log, it will not come in the form that you would like it to be in. So don't shy away from taking log in a limit. Correct, Ruchir, Parik. Yes, Ruchir Singh, that's correct. You are on the right track. Then you have to take anti-log of that. Okay, so let's solve this in the interest of time. First of all, n factorial. No Kirtan. Okay, and this n to the power n also you can distribute it like this. Correct, Ruchir? Ruchir Singh. Okay, so let's say I call this limit as L. then take log to the base e on both the sides. When you do that, you'll get 1 by n log of all these quantities. You can write it like this. Okay. It's very obvious now that your rth term here in this particular series will become 1 by n log r by n. So it is very much in the form that you would like it to be in. So it is log of x, in fact, ln of x dx. Okay. Summation means integral. And you're summing it from r equal to 1 till n. That means your integral is from 0 to 1. Okay. But remember, when you evaluate it, you get ln L. You get ln L. Okay. What is log x integration?
X ln x minus x.
X log x minus x.
X ln x minus x, absolutely. 0 to 1. Now, when you put a 1, log will become a 0. And when you put a 0, x will become a 0. So, in either case, there will be a 0 over here. Okay. So, when you put a 1, there is a 0 minus 1. And when you put a 0, anyway, it will be 0 minus 0. So, answer is minus 1. So, your ln L is equal to minus 1. So L is e to the power, or you can say 1 by e. This is your answer. Okay, very famous question. Keeps coming in many limit exercises. Yeah, I mean, see, it's subjective to you. You can try that out also. Evaluate limit n tending to infinity 1 by n square secant square 1 by n square 2 by n square secant square 4 by n square till 1 by n secant square 1. Oh, wow, one second. Advik wants me to go to the previous slide. Just a second, Advik. Yeah, do you want me to drag it somewhere? To the top. Okay. Okay, thank you. Okay, Richard. RP. Richard Parikh. Vikas, check your working. Okay. Two different types of answers I am getting. Okay, so let's look into this. So TR here is, if I'm not mistaken, TR is one, is R by N square, secant square, R square by N square, correct? If you pull out a 1 by N factor, it becomes R by N. Okay, so TR is x secant square x square. Okay, integration, summation means integration, and you are integrating it from 0 to 1 because you are summing it from 1 to n. Now, first of all here, I will take my x square to be t. So x dx will be half of dt. So it's basically, this is 0 to 1 again, secant square t dt. So that is nothing but tan of t from 0 to 1. Now tan 1 doesn't mean pi by 4. Some of you have misinterpreted it. Okay, so it's tan 1 minus tan 0, which is actually half tan 1. Okay. It's not pi by 4, it is 1. Tan 1 radian. Tan 1 radian is tan 1 only. You can't write 1 for this. I know, it happens. It happens. Okay, try this one out. Can I go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Sure. Yeah. Correct, Richard. Parik. Is that difficult? I think only one of you have got the answer so far. Okay, let's discuss this. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to do some minor manipulations. Okay. This guy in the denominator, let me write down the denominator first. This guy in the denominator needs a 1 by n, right? So I'll provide it with 1 by n. Okay. I'll also provide it with r by n. So if you see closely, I've provided it with 1 by n square. Okay. So I'll do the same thing over here. I'll provide this with 1 by n. Okay. And I'll provide this also with 1 by n. Okay. Now the problem is I don't have a function of r by n over here. What to do? Okay. So for that, there is a simple trick we can do. We can do r by root n over here and root n by r over here. Right? So all the n's are getting compensated now. And not only that, you also get a function of r by n everywhere. Okay. So the algebra of limit allows me to evaluate these limits separately. Okay. So I can evaluate this limit separately. Root of r by n. This limit separately. Under root of n by r. Okay. And the denominator. Ruchir Singh, that's correct. Your answer is correct. Okay. Now directly let me write down the function without much issues. So this is 0 to 1 root x into 0 to 1 by root x. And here we have 0 to 1 x. Is that fine? So this guy will give you x to the power 3 by 2 divided by, so it will be 2 by 3. Okay. This is x to the power minus half plus 1, which is 2 root x. Okay. And this term will give you again 1 by 2. So this will give you 8 by 3 as the answer. So only two of you could get it, both the Ruchirs. Okay. Let's take Let me put the poll on. Okay, only one person has answered so far. Last 30 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Please vote. Okay, just 12 of you have voted so far. Mostly you say option A. Option A. See, again, you take a log of this limit L. Let's say this is L. Correct? So when you do that, you end up getting limit n tending to infinity 1 by n, okay, and log of these quantities. So you'll have 1 by n log of sine pi by 2n plus log of sine 2 pi by 2n and so on. And this will go all the way till log sine n minus 1 pi by 2n. So basically it is going till this, right? Am I right? Okay.
Yes.
So please make a note that there was an n minus 1 pi by n over here. Correct. So, if you write this nth term over here, your nth term would be 1 by n log r pi by 2n, sorry, sine r pi by 2n, my bad. Sine r pi by 2n, okay? And when you're summing this up, means you're integrating this. Now summation is happening from r equal to 1 till 2n minus 1. Am I right? Your r is becoming 2n minus 1. Correct. So your limit of integration will become from 0 to 2. So what I'll do first, I'll write this as dx and I will write this as x. 0 to 2. Got the point?
Wait, so why is it till 2 into n minus 1?
So it is going till n minus 1 pi by n, no? So if I put a 2 here.
Yes. Oh, yeah, I didn't.
If I put a 2 here, 2. Yeah, that's where your limit of integration will become wrong. Okay. That's a very important part. Now, we can take here pi x by 2 as a t, let's say. Pi x by 2 is a t, let's say. So dx is 2 by pi dt, right? So it will become log of sine t 2 by pi dt. Remember, on the left side, you have ln of L. Now, what about the limit of integration? When x is 0, t is also 0. When x is 2, t is pi. Okay. Here we can use half the limit property. So it will become 4 by pi, 0 to pi by 2, ln of sine t. Ln of sine t from 0 to pi by 2, I told you to remember this result. It will really save a lot of time for you. What was the result? The result was pi by 2 ln half, isn't it? So ln of L is going to be this. So pi, pi gone. So ln L becomes 2 ln half. 2 ln half is ln 1 fourth. So direct comparison will tell you L is 1 fourth. Option C is correct. Janta was wrong. Okay. So please note, remembering these results really saves a lot of time for you. Else you'll have to sit and do all those halving the limit and, you know, using King's property and all those stuff. Is that fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now remember, summation and integration, they are interchangeable. Sometimes question on this concept also comes in JEE exams. Okay, please understand, summation and integration are both the same things. So their positions are sometimes interchangeable. Let me take a question on the same. If you permit, can I go to the next slide?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Find or evaluate limit n tending to infinity, summation from k equal to 0 till n, nck by n to the power k, k plus 3. How will you do this question? Any idea? Okay. Let us discuss this. Okay, here. Let's discuss this. So this term that you have, you can write it as limit n tending to infinity 1 by k plus 3 times nck into 1 by n to the power k. Okay. Correct. Now what I'm going to do is this guy over here, I'm going to replace it with integration of x to the power k plus 2 from 0 to 1. Okay. Is that fine? No problem so far. Just have a good look at it and tell me if you have any problem in writing this step. Okay. So now what I'll do is, oh, where was the summation symbol? Yeah, summation symbol, I forgot. Yeah. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to write this like this. Integration 0 to 1. Okay. Summation will come inside. Dx. Okay. This concept works because summation and integration, both basically both positions can be interchanged. Okay. Now, if you look at this, it basically says x square you can take outside because x square is not a part of the summation. So x to the power k by n to the power k n c k. Now, I'm sure this must ring a bell in your mind. This is nothing but summation n c k x by n to the power k. Recall your binomial days. What is this basically? This is a binomial term, correct? So it will be x square 1 plus x by n to the power of n. Okay. Now, limit also can be introduced inside here. Limit n tending to infinity. Limit n tending to infinity. Now this term, if you evaluate the limit, you all know that it is going to give you e to the power x. It's a standard, 1 to the power infinity form that you have also seen in the past. So this guy is e to the power x. Okay, 1 to the power infinity form. So ultimately your problem boils down to evaluating integral of x square e to the power x from 0 to 1. Okay, now I can use my DI method for here because I have to do integration by parts more than once. So I prefer using DI method. So 2x e to the power x, 2 e to the power x, 0 e to the power x, plus, minus, plus. You don't have to put a sign here. So just multiply these. Tic-tac-toe method. I hope you all remember tic-tac-toe method. So your answer is going to be x square e to the power x minus 2x e to the power x plus 2 e to the power x from 0 to 1. When you put a 1, you get e minus 2e plus 2e. And when you put a 0, you end up getting 0, 0 here and you get a 2 here. Have I missed out anything? Do let me know. Correct? Anything I missed out? I hope not. Okay. So this gives you answer as E minus 2. That is your answer for this question. Is that fine?
So could you scroll to the left a bit?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So wherever summation is there, you can put the limit next to it, which I had forgotten. Limit n tending to infinity, k equal to 1 till n. See, I'll explain once again. So what I did was I introduce integration over here, which is this term. Okay. Then what I did was 0 to 1 dx integration, I brought it outside and the summation process I introduced inside. Okay, like this. Once I did that, remember, x to the power 2 can be pulled out from the summation process because summation is applied to k. So only k related terms I have kept inside.
Okay. But how can you just switch the integration and the...
Both are summation process, no? Both are summation process. So both mathematically mean the same thing. Okay, so I have forgotten limit n tending to infinity here. I hope you can figure it out. Now, once you get this term is a familiar term to us. It comes from 1 plus x by n to the power n expansion, binomial expansion, isn't it? Okay. K should be starting from 0 in this case, if I'm not. Yeah, K should be starting from 0 in this case. Yeah, 0, 0, 0. So I was writing 1 by mistake. Yeah. So this is a binomial expansion for this. So I replaced it back over here. But at the same time, limit of this as n tends to infinity will become e to the power x from your standard 1 to the power infinity form. So ultimately, the whole question boils down to integrating x square e to the power x dx 0 to 1. A similar question came in NICER exam. NICER, ICER, you know, for getting into pure sciences. This question was there, actually. Clear, Ruchir Singh?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So with this, we close this topic.